Hi, I'm Norah Jones, and today I'm playing along with Mavis Staples.
I'm just playing along with you. I'm just playing along with you.
Hi, welcome to the show. I'm Norah, and with me as always is Sarah Oda.
Hello, hello.
Today's show was so fun to record and pretty emotional. I don't know how you felt about it, Oda, but for me, it was very, very special.
I feel like Mavis Staples is a force.
Yes.
But like a very sweet, tender, loving, huggable force.
Yeah, I know what you mean. Like, yeah, she's just an amazing human. She is full of love. And we love her.
You cannot be in a bad mood when she's in the room.
No. And we talk about that a little in this episode, about her energy and where it comes from. Mavis Staples, of course, was part of the Staples Singers.
Mavis and her family were iconic throughout the Civil Rights Movement. Her father was friends with Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.
Yeah.
And they performed at rallies and protests before his speeches. They inspired people when people needed it the most.
We enjoyed talking to Mavis about her family and the dynamic of the Staples Singers, Pops. And, of course, now she's also a solo artist in her own right. She's influenced so many people. Everybody loves her.
And aside from the incredible music that she makes, all the stories that come along with the history she's had and the people she's encountered along the way, I mean, I could just listen to her talk all day long.
Yeah. We talk about all this, and we sing several songs together, some that I didn't even know we were going to sing in this episode, so that was really fun. She just goes with it at all times, and that's what's so fun about being around Mavis. I met her for the first time in 2010 when we were both honoring Paul McCartney at the Kennedy Center Honors.
Yeah.
And she saw me. We talk about this too, but she saw me, and she took my hand, and she said, "Oh, hey.
She'd you be you
my
under
daughter."
Her wing.
Yeah. She just hugged me, and it was just, you know, pure love ever since then. So I was so honored that Mavis could join me and we could play songs together and reconnect. It's been a long time since I'd seen her.
Yeah. And we recorded this episode at Jeff Tweedy's studio in Chicago called The Loft, and start off by talking about a song that he wrote for her called "You Are Not Alone."
I hope you enjoy.
So that's the Mavis corner.
I didn't know that when I was here.
You don't have a corner?
I don't.
They got to get.
I've been all over the nooks.
Yeah,
you've even been in the drum
all
booth.
All in the nooks and crannies.
Yeah.
Well, I tell you, I got my first Grammy from here.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah.
You're Not Alone.
I was
from the Staples thing, just Mavis.
Uh huh.
Yeah, that was my first Grammy.
That's one of the most beautiful songs I've ever heard.
It is beautiful. And you and I got down on it, too, in the Apollo.
Yeah, I was hoping we could start with it, actually, just to warm us up. Yeah.
Okay, no problem.
Yeah.
I know the words to that.
Did whenever he brought it to you, were you moved by the lyrics?
I was just, and see what he did. He was writing it right here in the studio.
Really?
And I was standing over him, and he got through that first verse, and chill bumps came up, you know. And all of a sudden, he stopped. I'm waiting for him to go into the second verse, and he stopped. And I said, "What you doing?" He says, "I need more time. I need more time." He says, I said, "Oh, Tweety." And he said, "I'm going to have it for you tomorrow. I got to take it home. I'm going to have it for you tomorrow." I said, "Okay, Tweety." But he gave me the part of the melody. And I laid with that the night I was at home. And when I came in the next day, he laid it on me.
Man.
And I tell you, it just hit me. And because at that time, you know, I was feeling alone.
Really?
Yeah. I had lost my sister, my oldest sister. And my other sister was sick.
Man.
You know, so it the song hit me, you know, it was for me. It was for me.
It feels made for you.
Yeah. It was made for me. And I love it. We sing it every show. We don't go off the stage without singing "You're Not Alone."
I've heard you sing this many, many times.
Yeah.
I love it. The audience feels it.
Sometimes I walk around the house singing it.
Really? Well, if you feel alone?
I don't really feel alone. I just love the song. I'm doing okay now. See, I got you, babe.
I love you.
I love you too, little girl.
Well, let's try it.
Okay.
You want to try it?
Yeah, yeah.
I love, the thing I love about this song is how there's harmony the whole way through.
Yes.
And it has that not alone feeling.
It
even
does.
It's
it
so
does.
Beautiful.
And it just, and it makes you feel so much better.
Yeah.
It makes you feel like you're telling the truth. You're not alone.
I know.
You're not alone. And I tell you, people love it. People, as soon as we hit it, they go kabang.
It's the best.
Hit it. There's no need to be afraid. Open up, this is a raid. I wanna get it through to you. You're not alone. No, no, I wanna get it through to you. Get it through to you. You're me.
Oh, my gosh.
Help me.
That was pretty. Thanks.
Oh, that's a beautiful. You are so. You played all that.
Oh.
Those notes and that. And that dream. Isn't that beautiful?
So beautiful.
I don't know how Tweety.
A broken
he's a
dream.
Great writer. A broken dream.
Heart. Oh, it hurts.
We're going to be in tears.
It truly hurts.
It's over.
I just love it so much. And I love Jeff.
I was so glad you sang that with me at the Apollo.
That was really fun.
And at first, they couldn't find the piano.
Oh, well, I played it on a Wurlitzer, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I prayed. I said, he's going to get her a piano. And here they come.
You prayed for a piano for me?
Yeah.
I'm honored.
Yes, indeed.
That was really fun. That was your birthday.
It was my 80th.
That's crazy.
Check that out.
Wow.
You helped me celebrate my birthday.
That was the second time because I was with you in Newport on one of your birthdays at the Folk Festival.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. That must have been my 70th.
Probably, I think, I don't know.
I don't either.
I can't remember.
I stopped trying to remember.
I don't remember stopped. How old I am sometimes.
No, so come on.
I get it. Yeah.
Yeah. But who cares?
I don't feel like
any different.
I feel like we're buds and we're this could be the same age, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like it doesn't
Oh my God.
Doesn't
That's
feel
beautiful.
It doesn't feel very different.
It doesn't feel very different.
Though you've got a lot more experience than me.
You know, yes. And I'm the old girl. I'm the senior. I'm the golden girl. But I'm hanging with young blood.
You are, and people love you. Young people love you.
That makes me feel so good.
It's you know, you walk into the room, and you make me feel young.
Yeah.
I don't know. You just bring the sunshine with you.
Yeah, it really makes me feel good that the young adults. I have one friend who works at Columbia College over here. And she teaches, you know, she teaches music and she tells her students stories. And she lets me know, she said, Mavis, these kids love you. These kids, no, you don't know her, Hermit, Terry Hermit. You know her?
No.
Yeah. But she tells me all the time, and it makes me feel so good.
They do, though. They love you so much.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, see, they see that I'm a kid, too.
You are. I gotta admit, I agree.
Yeah, I've never grown up.
Yeah.
In my heart, I'm still a little kid, you know? And I love to play. I love to sing. I just love people. So, I love babies.
Yeah?
Oh, man.
Are you?
I take everybody's baby.
Are you good with them?
I'm good with them.
Yeah.
Oh, we get on a plane. And I always take this little bottle of bubbles with me.
Just in case.
Some baby is going to cry on that plane. And I wait on it. When I hear a baby cry, I get my bubbles out, find the baby, and I start blowing bubbles. And the baby looks at the bubbles, and mama be so happy
That's so sweet.
Yeah. I'm bubbles.
Yeah,
you know,
that's your nickname, right?
That's my nickname, yeah.
Yeah, who gave you that nickname?
My mother.
Really? Since
and
you were
I
a little girl?
Her, hmm?
Since you were little?
No, not. It wasn't until I was about, I wasn't 30 yet. I was in my 20s.
Okay.
And I asked, I said, Mama, why you call me Bubbles? She said, Mavis, because you're so bubbly. You're just always so happy. You just, you know.
You came out that way, huh?
I came that way.
I was going to ask that.
Yeah.
Where that comes from. But I think people who have that just are like that.
I'm just happy-go-lucky all the time, you know.
Well, that's a great way to be.
It really is.
Yeah.
And I'm grateful because every now and then I'll let something get on my nerve. But it's got to be strong.
Yeah.
You know, because most of the time I overlook it. Whatever, you know, if it was supposed to get on my nerve, I can overlook it and stay happy.
That's
you know?
Great. I'll take some of that, please.
All right.
Can I have some of that?
Just free of charge.
I'm pretty happy in general, but I'm not a bubbly person. You know what I mean? Like, I don't bring the sunshine into every room, but I don't get too sad usually. I'm pretty even.
Yeah.
I have my moments.
But you don't realize it. But you do bring the sunshine.
Well, that's kind of you. But I mean, and when I'm talking about you bringing the sunshine, you're on a whole other level.
Well, I come in noisy. I have a noisy crew.
Yeah.
You know, but yeah. And Prince used to tell me, he said, Mavis, you're talking too loud.
Really?
Save your voice. Yeah.
What a thing to say.
I was grateful, though, because also Roberta Flack told me that.
Really?
But I've always, you know, there were five of us children in the house.
Yeah.
And if you want to be heard, you got to let your voice be heard. I come from a noisy crew, just like I say, all of
them. Yeah, big
all
families.
Of us are noisy.
That's what it's about, right?
But, right. And I'm just grateful. I know I should talk softer. Save my voice.
I think at this point you're good. Did they say that out of concern for your singing voice?
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, I get that, but if it hadn't been a problem yet,
right?
Then
right. I've been talking loud all my life.
Yeah, I don't think it's gonna be a problem.
But I guess they were just used to being around people who talked under their voice. You
yes.
know? And now he. I was surprised his voice was so, Mavis.
Prince, he had a low speaking voice,
yes,
right?
Yes.
Yeah, I met him once. But he was very soft spoken.
He was.
And he observed a lot, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I took him to, I said, Prince, it's just going to have to make you my son. All right, Mavis, I'll be your son. And I'd love to hear him talk because his voice was just roar.
Yeah.
You know, but when he sing, you know, he's a heavy voice when he sing too, but to talk. I saw him do an interview with Arsenio Hall one time. And man, his voice, Arsenio was shocked. He was shocked too. But some people talk in a different voice than they sing.
My kids told me that when they hear my voice singing, they think I sound different when I'm just home, you know, telling them what to do. That's what they tell me.
Oh, yeah, they tell you. Your voice, your singing voice is very mellow and sweet and soft. And you could make a person hurt themselves.
Yeah. Comes from listening to all the
you just
old
calm,
song.
You just calm you down. You see, when I first heard, what's the name of
it? Oh, Don't Know Why.
Don't Know Why. When I first don't know why, I was around the house doing something, and that came on the radio. And I stopped whatever I was doing. I had to stop and listen. And then the next time I said, damn, that's a beautiful song. Next time I heard it, I saw you were on television. And I was walking around the house again. The TV was on and you came on. And I said, there's that song. I saw you. I said, oh, my goodness. That's her singing it. And it's just been one of my favorites of all time.
Thank you.
My
friend Jesse Harris wrote that song.
Really?
He was in my band, and he wrote the song.
I thought you wrote it.
Sometimes people think I wrote it, but he wrote it. I wrote a few songs on that album, but I didn't really get deep into songwriting until a little bit later.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Well, you sing it like you wrote it.
I think you have to, don't you?
Yes.
You have to feel like you own the song to really deliver it.
Oh, my
Even if
God.
You didn't come up with it.
Right.
And that's what you do with the Jeff Tweedy song.
Yes.
And that's what you do with every song. I mean—
Really
That's
do.
That's what you have to do.
You really do. You've got to come from your heart.
Yeah.
It's got to come from your heart. If you want to deliver it and you want people to get it and feel it and react from it the way you have, that's the way you got to do. You know, Pops always told me, we were in New York one time, I was about 13 years old. And these kids sang before us, and they were just jumping all across the stage and singing loud. So when it was time for us to sing, I did that.
Yeah.
And my father snatched me off the stage. He said, what is wrong with you, Mavis?
Wow.
He said, what are you doing? I said, I'm just singing, Dad. He said, Mavis, let me tell you something. Your music don't need a gimmick. You don't need a gimmick.
Yeah.
You know, you sing from your heart. Sing what comes from the heart reaches the heart. And that's the way I've never forgotten it. Never. You know. And he said, you don't have to clown. You don't need to give me. I was trying. The kids, they were jumping across the stage.
Yeah.
Singing loud. And he says, you singing sacred music. You don't need any gimmick. Sing from your heart. If you sing from your heart, you'll reach the people.
I agree with that 100%. Yeah. I think his voice also had that mellow, easygoing.
Yeah.
He wasn't trying to sing over anybody, but you had to lean in
right,
to hear
right,
it.
Right.
And then it hit you.
Right.
Right.
And you're the same way. You know, you laid back.
I don't know where. I don't know why. But.
I'm just so proud to know you, little lady.
Oh, I'm proud to know you. I met you at the Kennedy Center for the first time.
Yes.
And you took my hand and
sure
you saw
did.
I was nervous.
I remember.
You knew I was nervous.
I knew you
were. Yeah, you could tell.
I could tell.
So you took me and you held me. You like hugged
me. I sure did. I said, I got to protect this little girl.
I was like, what am I doing here?
Yeah, I came on down there and got you and had you stand right by me and we held hands all through that finale.
Yes, that was so fun. It was so special meeting you there.
Oh, man, that was a good time.
Yeah.
That was a good time. Anytime I see your name, I flare up. You know.
That could go either way.
And I was seeing you so much. Like you told me yesterday, you said it was Christmas. But Christmas needed you. I would Aww. See you. It really needed you.
You know what? I needed Christmas last year. And that's why I made a Christmas album. Because I needed a little joyful something to feel good.
Well, I'm glad you made that album because they were featuring you all week, all day, every hour. I said, there she is again.
Christmas exhaustion.
Oh, it was beautiful.
But, you know, we recorded the song from your Christmas, the Staples Singers Christmas album. We did the 25th day of December.
Did you?
I'll send it to you. It wasn't on the album, but it was a bonus track.
Oh, please.
Because I didn't feel
it.
Like we made it. It was so, your version is so good. It was hard to beat it. So.
Oh, my goodness.
But it's great. It's still a great version. And it's a great, you know, I listened to your Christmas album a lot. When
really?
We were recording. Yeah.
Really? Oh, and that was so many years ago.
Yeah.
Wow.
But it's beautiful.
It's a beautiful album. And Pops, he wrote the song, There Was a Star.
He did?
Yeah, he wrote that.
Ah.
And, oh, my God. For a long time you couldn't find it. We couldn't find it.
Oh, they had to reissue it.
Yeah, and the Blind Boys, they did some songs from that album, but I got to hear 25th Day because that was my favorite.
It was so
January,
fun.
February, March, April, and May, June, July, August, September, October, November. It was the last month of the year.
Oh, yeah. The 25th day of December.
Did I leave that out?
No, I mean, I kept saying when we were recording it, I kept saying the 21st day of December just because it rolled off my tongue wrong. And my drummer, Brian Blake, he goes, Norah, I think that's one lyric you got to get right. This is the 25th day of December, not the 21st day of December.
Jesus' birthday.
Yeah, don't get that one right.
No. Yeah, and Pops brought that to Pops. Said, tell me when was my Jesus born? Last month of the year. When was Jesus born? Last month of the year. When was Jesus born? Last month of the year. You got January, February, March, April, and May, June, July, August, September, October, November. It was the 25th day of December. It was the last month of the year. Born by the Virgin Mary. Last month of the year. He was born by the Virgin Mary. Last month of the year. Born by the Virgin Mary. Last month of the year. We got
January.
Uh-huh.
February.
Yeah.
March.
that's April and May. Oh, June, July, August, September, no, November, it was the 25th day of December, it was the last month of the year.
I love it.
Oh, that was fun.
Yeah, it was fun.
Oh, my goodness. Yeah, well, we're having Christmas today.
That's right. I love the end of that song. Last month of the year. So how low can you go, Mavis?
Huh?
How low can you go?
I can go down low.
Oh, my gosh.
I can go down low.
Whoa.
How low can you go? I can go down very low.
That is amazing. But did you, were you like that when you were younger?
You know, my voice was so heavy.
Always.
And I take it from my mother and my grandmother. They had strong voices. But when I was a kid, it was, my voice is higher now when I get my tonsils removed.
Oh, really?
It got higher, yeah.
That's so weird.
I used to really be, I would fight. Kids would tell me, you sound like a boy.
Wow.
And when we started traveling, if I called down for breakfast, the lady would say, yes, Mr. Staples.
Yes, sir. Yes, Mr.
I said, and I heard it so much the last time. I said, I'm a lady. And they said, oh, I'm sorry. You know, but yeah, it's always been, I've always had a heavy voice. And I used to sing bass, our first record. You know,
really?
I sing, will, oh.
That's insane. And how old were you?
I was a kid. I was like 9 years old.
That's when Uncloudy Day came out?
Oh, no, Uncloudy Day came when I was 13.
Okay.
12, 13. But they wanted to record us when I was a kid, and Pops wouldn't allow it. The president of VJ Records, Vivian Carter, she called Daddy. She said, Stape, you, those kids, y'all need to be on record. And Pops said, well, Vivian, I don't know nothing about those records. You know, he was... All of us were green. We just, you know, and he said, I'm not going to let my children get on those records.
He was afraid because you were too young.
Right.
He didn't know what it would bring.
He didn't know business of it.
Wow.
And my sister Yvonne, she would go, she wouldn't have books. She got this big red book, this business of music. She learned, she helped him a lot.
Really?
People, oh, yeah.
She got that book and helped you guys figure it out.
She sure did.
That's incredible.
Yeah, she sure did. She stayed right with him, you know, booking. And she taught him a lot. But also people like the Soul Stirrers and Sister Mahalia Jackson, they were already recording. Mm-hmm. And they would tell Daddy different things. You know, they would tell him, you know, what to do and how to do. And
Watch out for this.
So when I was about 12, Pops called Vivian and told her, he said, okay, Vivian, we'll make that record now. I'll let my children make
and after he'd read the book.
Yeah, after yeah. He'd do the business.
He felt good and confident.
He was bad. Yeah, see, because Pops didn't know, you know, we were just singing.
Yeah.
He used to sing with an all-male group. Six guys, and these guys wouldn't come to rehearsal. So Pops would be frustrated. He'd come home mad, you know. He came home that third time, and he went in the closet, pulled out a little guitar that he had. We didn't even know he had a guitar.
He couldn't play it?
He could play it. He didn't have all the strings, but he could make it sound good. And he told my Aunt Katie, he said, I'm going to sing with my children. He called all of us into the living room. Sit us down on the floor in a circle and begin giving us voices that he and his sisters and brothers used to sing when they were in Mississippi.
That's incredible.
People thought we were old people. We would go places, and they just knew we were old people. They'd heard us because we had a little radio, 15-minute radio show,
mm-hmm.
Sunday morning, and we would sing. And they thought we were old people because Pops, we were singing those old voices like his sisters and brothers. We would walk in little stair steps, and they'd say, that's the Staple singing.
They thought you were old already.
Yeah. But
that's incredible.
Yeah, he would give us those voices, and that's how we started singing. My Aunt Katie lived with us.
Okay.
And she came through one night. She says, Chucks, y'all sound pretty good.
And that
I
felt good.
I want y'all to sing in my church Sunday.
Had you already been singing in church your whole lives?
No. We've been singing. We hadn't, as the family,
No.
We hadn't been singing in church. We didn't start, we started doing programs at churches. But my sister and brother were in the young people's choir.
At church.
I was too young to go.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you didn't really sing much until he started doing that.
Until he started us singing.
What's your order? There's five of you kids.
I'm the baby.
You're the baby?
Yeah.
Okay, Bubbles. I get it now.
Yeah, I'm the baby. Oh no, Cynthia. I was the baby for 12 years.
Oh wow.
And my baby sister came along.
Ooh.
And you know I didn't like
How
that.
Did that go?
I didn't like that. I would be putting diapers on that baby and I'd stick her. Mama said, "Maybe you were sticking that baby." I said, "No, ma'am, Mama." But Cynthia and I became the best of friends. We became the tight. I called her Blessed.
Aww.
And she called me Reba. She couldn't say my name.
Aww.
Reba?
Aww.
She was. I told Pops, I said, "We got to put Cynthia in." She would sing songs with us when we were in Chicago at the different churches, you know. But yeah, Cynthia, and see, Mama and Daddy, they were just, my mother was heavy set. So I never knew she was pregnant, you know.
Oh, she just happened. All of a
I didn't
sudden.
Know where this baby came from. And they told me to pacify me. Because when my mother came home, she didn't bring the baby. She had to leave the baby there.
Oh.
And Mama said, "You go with Roebuck, pick up the baby." I said, "What baby?
What baby?" Oh, my gosh.
And they started telling me that we had this baby, and so they let me name her.
They did?
Cynthia Marie.
Thinking you'd be cool with it if you got your name?
That's going to pacify
like
me.
Like your baby.
I named her, yeah. But, oh, boy. And see, because what happened, my father, he would pass me up. He'd go straight to that baby bed or wherever she was and blow. He used to blow in my stomach, make me laugh, mm-hmm. throw me up in the air when he'd come from work, and all that stopped.
Oh.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so somebody should have been around to talk to him, let him know he was supposed to keep doing that.
That's interesting.
Yeah.
I grew up an only child. So it's like just, I can't even imagine what it was like being in a family like that.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
It was good being in a family. We would disagree. We didn't have any, we fuss sometimes. But
you would.
Mama would tell us, "Don't do that. You have to love your sister. And that's your sister. Now you all make up. Apologize. Make up." But, you know. Yvonne and Cleetie, they would do most of the arguing.
Oh, yeah, because they were the close, older sisters.
They were the two oldest, yeah.
That makes sense.
Yeah.
Whenever you guys were traveling, how old were you when you started really traveling around and, touring, I guess? But,
oh, yes, we were touring. We were.
How old were you when that started?
I was like about 13.
Wow.
Uncloudy Day was a hit.
It was a hit, and you were 13 years old.
On Cloudy Day, this woman called Pop. She said, "Staples, this record is selling like an R&B. And it turned out that it was the first gospel record to sell a million.
That's insane.
It was, yeah. It was the first gospel. Ah. But we would go to down south. We would go to Milwaukee, Gary, all around Chicago and sing. And people would bet. The disc jockey, when we went to New Orleans, Memphis, the disc jockey would get on the radio and say, "This is little Mavis Staples. This little girl is singing this." People would bet that I was not a little girl.
Yeah, because you had that deep bass.
I'm saying, well, oh.
Yeah.
Lord, they tell me now. And I got a home.
Oh.
Got a home. And can you imagine? I'm a little girl, a little skinny girl.
And you're short now, so you probably be.
I was even shorter. I was even shorter. But they would bet. And what we would do, we would fool the people. We would sing Uncloudy Day down in Harmony. Oh, they tell me all of that. And then get to the end of it, and I come in with, well, oh. So what happened was my brother at that, people would be sitting on the edge. They've been, all of these people have bet that I am not a little girl. Mm-hmm. And all of a sudden, Purvis move up, my brother, like he's going to sit, and you'd hear the people, I told you that wasn't no little girl. I told you that wasn't. And I'm easing her. And I said,
you're playing a trick.
Well, I ease into the mic, and they look up, and it's really a little girl. Oh, we had so much fun with that.
But that's so fun to travel with your family. Did it ever get sticky?
Nah.
No, you always
didn't have any problem.
Even throughout, as you got older?
All of it. The only thing Yvonne and Cleetie would argue about was what to wear. One of them wanted to wear this and one of them wanted to wear that. And see, because, you know, my brother, he left the group in 1969 and hurt me so bad.
Really?
Because Purvis and I, we had this clap. Nobody could do that clap the way we would.
Oh, yeah.
And he just got grown. A man, you know, men, they get tired of doing what their father tell them to do. You know, he wanted to be his own man. Because mm-hmm. Pop's asking. Pop said, Purr, you sure you don't want to just take a leave of absence? No, Daddy. Nope, I quit.
Done. Yep.
So, and just as he quit, I'll take you there, hit.
Oh.
And his friends would mess with him. He'd go into one of their bars or whatever, and they put a quarter in a jukebox and play, I'll take you there. Oh. I said, y'all shouldn't do that to him. Yeah, but he did all right. He managed the emotions for a while.
Oh, wow. So yeah. He got into the business.
Yeah. Oh, he was still in the business.
Yeah.
He was still in the business.
But the other side of it.
Right. Right.
Wow.
They were gospel singers at first. And they were our little friends, the Hutchison Sunbeams. I mean, they wanted to sing R&B. And so that's when Purvis took them down to Stax, got him a choreographer, taught him some steps. And they had some hits.
That's amazing. Right. I mean, it's amazing to me how close you guys stayed, and that there was there could have been a lot of drama there.
Oh yeah, oh yeah. But my mother wouldn't allow it. Mama and Daddy, you know, they just taught us. They taught us. We grew up loving one another.
That's so special, though, and it's.
It really
it feels
is.
Unique. I don't know.
You're an only child. Bless your heart.
I do have a half-sister who's 2 years younger than me, but we both grew up separately. So
did you?
We didn't know each other till we were a little older.
Oh, wow.
So, but, only child. That sounds like a party to me.
Yeah. Oh, my God. Yeah, because are you spoiled? Of course you are.
Don't know. But if you ask my mother, she would tell you a different answer than me, maybe.
Well, you know, I met your mom.
Yeah, you did.
Yes.
She's very
I'll
tall.
I'll call her anytime and ask her.
Oh, man.
She is tall.
She's tall.
Yeah.
And I'm short. She's 5'10". I'm 5'1".
Yeah.
So I didn't really, I might have been spoiled, but I never messed with her. Like, I was a good kid because I didn't want her to get mad. She was so tall.
Oh, yeah, she was tough. And by her being so tall, you said, I better not mess with her.
Yeah.
But all you had to do was leap up.
Oh, just,
jump.
I don't think that would have flown with her, Sue.
You did the right thing.
No.
Listen to Mom. Mom knows best.
I try.
Yeah. You try.
I try.
Oh, my God.
Oh, man. I was wondering, do you remember the first song you sang with Pops when he was teaching you?
Oh, yeah. The very first song my father taught us was Will the Circle Be Unbroken?
Ah.
Yeah.
I love that
Will
song.
Will the Circle Be Unbroken? And, that was his favorite. And on our records, we recorded it about 4 or 5 times.
Yeah.
But on the records, Pops is singing. And I love to hear Pops sing.
I do. Because
he was so smooth.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he was a singer like you. He was laid back. Look, Sly Stone came to Pops one day and said, hey, Pop, give me the bag. And Pops said, what you talking about? He said, come on, Bob, give me the bag. I know you got it.
Because he was so laid back.
Yeah,
he thought
yeah.
he was on drugs?
Yeah, they thought he was. And Purvis, my brother had to tell Daddy what Sly was talking about. And Pop taste. It's like, you come on, we'll choke you, boy. You know I don't do that mess.
That's too funny.
Yeah.
Give wow.
It was so funny.
That is funny.
Yeah, because they would all talk about how laid back Pop sing, you know, yeah. and his voice, it just flow.
Yeah.
But when he taught us Circle Be Unbroken, and we have sang it. We sang it with Johnny Cash on his television show. Mm. It was the Staples family and the Carter family. That was years ago.
That must have been fun.
It was fun.
Yeah.
It was for one of his specials, you know.
Oh, but, those TV specials.
Yeah, one of those TV specials.
Yeah, I love watching those.
Yeah. But and I sing it all the time. That's on my list on our shows. And Pop said, man, because we look at us as a family. That's our circle. And he put us in a circle when he started giving us the voices to sing.
It was, I can just picture it.
Yeah.
You're sitting down sitting in a little circle at
yeah.
home.
Yeah. Let me tell you, I'm going to sing some of it for you. You sing it too. You know
which key? What, yeah.
I don't know what key I sing in. Now, you know that.
I was thinking G.
I was standing.
Too low?
Huh?
Is that too low?
No, that's good. What'd you say key that is?
That's G.
Okay. That's a shame I don't know what key I sing at.
No, it's not. It probably has changed over the years.
I probably have.
Yeah.
I sing in some different keys, though, in our shows. But it's all right. I don't need to know what key I sing.
I can do it in any key. You just tell me.
Oh, no, I think that was good.
Okay.
I was standing. Is that where you were?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Window on a cold and cloudy day when I saw the hearse come rolling to carry my mother away. Will the circle be unbroken by and by, Lord, by and by? There's a better home awaiting in the sky, Lord, in the sky. I told the undertaker, please drive slow, 'cause this lady that you're hauling, oh, I hate to see her go. Will the circle be unbroken by and by, Lord, by and by? There's a better home awaiting in the sky, Lord, in the sky. I will follow close behind her, try to hold up and be brave, but I could not hold my sorrow when they laid her in the grave. Will the circle unbroken by and by, Lord, by and by? There's a better home awaiting in the sky, Lord, in the sky. In the sky, Lord, in the sky. In the sky, Lord, in the sky. Oh, yeah. Ooh, you sound just like Cleetie.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh,
my goodness. Oh, yeah, I heard Cleetie in your voice.
Oh.
Girl, don't stop me crying.
Oh.
I tell you, my sister Cleetie, she had the best soprano voice.
Really?
Oh.
So you were low and she was high.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
So you complimented.
And I credit her for the Staples singer's sound.
Really?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, wow.
And look, Aretha would be recording and she'd tell her sister Carolyn, "Now, Carolyn, I want you to sound like Cleotha."
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
That's amazing.
Yeah. And Carolyn was saying, Carolyn told me about it. She said, "Mavis, I told her I can't sound like Cleotha."
She was mad about it.
Aretha wouldn't even be mad. Oh, yeah. But it's a different, Pops would give Cleetie like a minor. She would go, like, I know what I'm talking about.
Yeah, you
but,
do.
No, I know,
well,
she would go
know.
Minor
yeah.
in some places. And but her voice, if you, on all of our old stuff, where Cleetie is singing, her voice stands out. And her soprano and Pops' guitar, that's the Staple singers.
I love his guitar so much.
That tremolo,
so just
and
cool.
He taught himself.
Well, that's what's good about it. It's just feeling, you know.
Right,
it's
right.
Simple.
Right.
It's simple, but it's got the thing.
That's what it,
yeah,
that
and it's
is,
got the sound.
The feeling, right.
When did he, how did he get that electric sound? Do you know how that came about?
Pop, I remember when he got that tremolo.
Because that wasn't typical then, right?
No,
for
no.
gospel music.
No. And some preachers didn't want Pops to play his guitar in their church. And Pops had to let them know, look, you read your Bible. String instruments are in the Bible. You know, the harp, the Pops would name them all. I guess, what's that other one? I can't call the name of it, but we just wouldn't go to the church if they wouldn't let Pops play his guitar. But he learned from a blues man, Charlie Patton.
Okay.
See, Pops was on this farm, Partridge Farm in Mississippi. And this man was a howling wolf. A lot of the blues singers were on this farm. And Pops would tell us how this man, Charlie Patton, would be playing. And look, we didn't know for years while we were singing gospel. Our father was playing the blues on his guitar.
Yeah, that's what it is. It's the marriage of those two things.
Yeah.
And that made it so unique.
Right,
yeah.
Right. But he went to the guitar store one day and he came back with this tremolo. He said, "Y'all listen to this." And he was strum and Elvis Presley told me one time. The first time, only time I ever saw him and the first time I ever saw him. We were in Memphis, and I was standing on the side. It was a Starlight Review outside, and I was standing over in the wing, and all of a sudden, he come in with one of his partners. They got these leather jackets on like they've been riding motorcycles, and we had sang. And he told me, he said, "I like the way your father played that guitar." I said, "Well, thank you." He said, "Yeah, he plays a nervous guitar."
A nervous guitar?
He called it a nervous guitar.
What does that mean? Because of the tremolo?
Because the tremolo was
shaking. Oh, it's shaking.
That was a good expression. I said, "Well,
I've never heard that before."
A nervous guitar. Yeah, that's what I'll never forget. And that was my meeting with Elvis Presley.
Wow.
I didn't know who he was. One of the guys, David Ruffin, who later sang with the Temptation, he was singing with a gospel group. He told me, he said, "Maybe you know who that guy was you was talking to?" I said, "No, I don't know." He said, "Blue suede shoes." I said, "That's him."
That's him.
That's the way he would let me know.
That's amazing.
Because of blue suede shoes.
Wow.
But yeah, Pops played a nervous guitar.
Did he laugh at that description?
Oh, did he laugh? Did he laugh? He told me, "Maybe why didn't you call me over to let me meet?" I said, "Dad, I didn't really know who he was. I was just, David told me who he was." Yeah, that was beautiful.
I love
that's
that.
That's a good expression of him, though, of Pops, his guitar.
Nervous guitar.
Because it does. It goes, oi, 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 oi.
That's just the funniest thing I've heard.
Yeah, Daddy, that's when he learned how to play his guitar, and he was always playing it in the house, you know, after he let us know he had a guitar.
Yeah.
Because we didn't know until those guys wouldn't come to rehearsal, and he decided we probably wouldn't be any Staple Singers if they had
come to rehearsal.
Yeah. So I thank them.
Wow, for being not there.
Not right, not serious about this. They were the trumpet, and they had a good group, too. Pops would sing lead, and Pops had a voice. He never went into his falsetto on the Staple Singer stuff.
Oh, but did then.
Oh, yeah. He would go into, tell me what are they doing up in heaven today? And then he'd go, peace, they by just like a river,
Ooh. They
say. Oh, Pops was bad.
Yeah.
And definitely. I recorded a song with Tweety.
That song?
What are they doing in heaven today?
Ooh.
I'm not singing it like Pops, though.
Well, that's Tweety. Okay. You sing like you.
I sing like me.
Yeah.
I sing like me. I'm so grateful to be talking to you, little lady.
Thank you.
You are so different from anybody else out here.
Really?
Yeah. Nobody sounds like you. Nobody... Well, give me a break.
But that's
when
what you want, right?
When I came to your show, huh?
But that's what you want, right? To be your own self?
To be different, yeah, right. And but I'm just honored, you know, I never thought I would meet you when I first heard you on the radio.
Mavis,
and you
I love you.
Don't know why. I said, listen to her. Who is she?
Yes. I'm still figuring it out, to
yes.
be honest.
Well, no. Well, you are a giant.
You're sweet.
You're a tiny little lady.
I'm a tiny
but
giant.
You are a giant. I tell you.
I love it.
And when I came to your show in Red Rocks.
Yeah, we did a show together.
Yes.
That was fun.
I started it off. I warmed them up for you.
You killed it. And I was nervous to go on after you.
Oh, cut it out.
I was.
Don't you even try that.
Of course I was.
Girl, those people, all those people that came out for you. And I noticed you were doing some songs that I hadn't heard.
Yeah.
And every time you would hit one of those songs, the crowd would roar.
That's so funny. That's one of my favorite audiences at Red Rocks. They're
really?
Always very loving.
Yes.
You've played there many times, right?
Yes, we have. We have. Oh, with different people. Let me see. Yours was the best, though.
Had fun. Mm-hmm. We had fun. We had recorded a song together that Pete Wren wrote. I don't know if you remember it, but I was wondering if you feel like trying it.
Oh, I it'll come to me as you go.
Yeah.
Because I that's been a while. What happened anyway? We were supposed to go on tour with that song.
We were gonna go on tour and then the pandemic hit.
Sure did.
Yeah. We were gonna do a bunch of shows together.
Yes, I remember. I was so happy.
Me too.
Oh man.
We gotta do it again. Yeah, really, we will.
Just gonna do it again.
We do it again.
And set it up. You set it up.
I'll be gone.
get so tired that I can't tell time. Don't you cry when I get to where I'm going. I'll be gone. I'll be gone.
Wish I could tell you that the sun gonna shine. I got a feeling that I still won't change my mind. Running out of time. There's a place on a mountain, you can take my bones, but I go home when I get to where I'm going. I'll be gone. Be gone. I gotta tell you that it's all gonna be just fine. But I don't wanna waste any more of your time. You didn't waste mine.
Oh, now you're talking about a beautiful song.
It's a beautiful song.
Oh, my goodness.
He wrote this a long time ago.
Really?
I mean, maybe 8 years, 9 years ago. And
yeah.
At one point, he mentioned, gosh, it would be cool to hear Mavis sing this song. I was like, you're right. But then, you know, I'm a little shy. Sometimes I have a hard time reaching out and asking people to do things.
But don't be that way with me.
I know.
Okay, now you know. You can come to me anytime with anything.
But it came full circle, but not for like 5 more years. And then I got unshy and I asked you to sing it.
Yeah.
And, yeah.
Yeah, I was so, that blew my mind. I said, oh, wow.
It's a great one.
That's what I wish I could play, a piano.
Piano?
Any instrument.
You never picked anything up?
I picked up the guitar.
Yeah.
I told Pops I wanted to play that guitar. And he tried to teach me, but he wasn't taught either. So and then there was a time when Pops was still frisky. I was young.
What does that mean?
I mean he wasn't ready to he didn't have time, gotcha. He didn't have the patience.
I think I took it the wrong way.
No, I didn't mean going out on mama now.
Yeah.
You know?
Gotcha.
That's frisky too.
Yeah.
But no, he just wasn't patient enough to.
Yeah.
So he got me a little training guitar. And he gave me about 3 lessons, and he was done. He said, Mavis, I tell you what, baby, you go down to Lion Healy. And I'm 11 years old. I don't know how to go downtown to Lion Healy.
To get lessons?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, to get lessons from them.
Yeah.
And I told him, I said, Daddy, I want to pick it like you and Sister Rosetta Tharpe. I don't want to, you know, but if I had learned how to strum— I think that would have made it easier for him to teach me.
Yeah.
You know, to pick.
Picking is harder.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah, strumming.
I know that's hard. But I would have been happy strumming.
Yeah.
You know.
I wanted to ask you about when you guys met Dr. Martin Luther King.
Yeah.
And you kind of switched from singing gospel to singing these freedom songs, protest
right.
songs.
Right.
I read something about Pops meeting him and saying he wants to sing his words.
Right.
That is the most beautiful thing I've
yes,
heard.
That was something.
Yeah.
See, Pops, he just happened. We were in Montgomery, Alabama one Sunday morning. We didn't have to work until that night. And Pops called my sisters and I to his room. And he told us, he said, listen, y'all, this man Martin is here. Martin Luther King. And he has a church here. He said, I've been listening to him on the radio. Dr. King had a radio show. And Pops had been listening to him. And he said, I'd like to go to his 11 o'clock service. Do you all want to go? We said, yeah, Daddy, we want to go. We all got in the car and went down to Dexter Avenue Baptist Church. And we were ushered in and seated. Someone let Dr. King know that we were in the service, and he acknowledged us. He said, we're glad to have Papa Staples mm-hmm. and his daughters here this morning. Hope you enjoyed the service. Well, we enjoyed the service. And as the service is over, the worshipers, Dr. King stands at the door to shake the worshipers' hands as they filed out. And Pops walked past, shook his hand. No, my sisters and I did first. We shook Dr. King. Oh, that was a feeling.
I bet.
We shook his hand. And Pops, we had to wait on him. He stood there and talked to him for a while. He finally came on. We get back to the hotel. He called us to his room again. And he said, listen, y'all, I like this man's message. I really like his message. And I think that if he can preach it, we can sing it.
Wow.
And we started writing freedom songs, March Up Freedom Highway, Why Am I Treated So Bad? We switched over because we didn't feel that it was anything wrong. We felt like this was close to gospel.
Yeah.
You know, we're singing the truth. You know, we joined the movement and we would sing before Dr. King would speak. We'd go to the meetings, and Dr. King would tell Pop, Stape, you're going to sing my song tonight, right? Pop would say, oh, yeah, doctor, we're going to sing your song. Why Am I Treated So Bad?
Yeah.
That was his favorite. And people ask me, what did he never talked to us girls. He never sit down, and he would just say something, how you girls doing this morning? Y'all doing all right? Yes, sir, Dr. King.
Wow.
But he wouldn't sit and hold. He and Pops would talk.
They would talk.
People ask me, what did he talk to you about? Well, he didn't talk to me. You know, but what I did remember mostly of Dr. King was his laughter. He had this laughter when he laughed. Because most of the time, I would see him, he either looked sad or serious,
mm-hmm.
you know. And when I'd hear him laugh, that would make my heart happy because I said, Dr. King is happy. And that would be most of the time when we'd be going to the meeting and the men would be in a huddle down in the parking lot. And all of a sudden you hear Dr. King laughing. That made me feel so good.
Wow.
But no, he never held a conversation with my sisters and I. He was just asking. He said the same way every time. How you girls doing this morning?
Wow. How much older was he? You were young still?
I was young, yeah.
How young were you then? I mean, I'm just in general.
In the 60s, 60, this was like about 63, 1963.
Okay.
So I was born in 39. I'm not good at math.
You were in your early 20s,
early 20s, you know.
I'm not
either. You do believe it? Yeah, I was in my early 20s.
Yeah.
But that was when we joined the movement.
Yeah.
And we became the soundtrack.
You did?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Congressman John Lewis would tell, he was my friend.
I bet.
Now, he was my friend. And I went to his office when I did a Freedom album with Rykuda. And I asked him if he would write my liner notes. And he said, baby, you know, you and your family, y'all kept us motivated, kept us inspired to keep on marching. Your songs, I said, yes, sir, doctor. Because I was surprised he remembered me.
Yeah.
I said, you, John, I hadn't seen him in years. And I was surprised they gave me a meeting in his office.
Of course he remembered you.
He did remember me. He said, yeah, baby, your family. And so he, I missed his birthday, invited me to his last birthday party, and I couldn't go. We were working, you know. But he was my friend to the end.
And, that's amazing.
Yeah. Congressman John Lewis.
That's beautiful.
We called him Uncle John.
Uncle John.
Yeah.
When you guys were writing songs, was everybody was collectively just sort of pitching in? Did Pops always have... Was he? Did he ever work on songwriting, like, on Pops, his own all the time? Or
yeah, he did. Pops was always jotting something down.
Yeah.
You know, and we would help him. We would put some words in on his song, but that's Daddy's song. We don't want any credit for.
Okay.
Right? We give them to Daddy, all of us.
Interesting.
Yeah, we drop words in. He goes, march up Freedom's highway, made up my mind. And I won't turn around, made up my, and there's this one thing, I can't understand, my friend. That I'm proud of that, because that was me.
Yeah.
Why some folk think freedom was not designed for all men? There are so many people living their life perplexed, wondering in their minds what's going to happen next. That's why we're going to march. Mm-hmm. You know, that was the very first one. We wrote for the movement, and boy, we moved on. We would sing that. We'd sing, Why Am I Treated So Bad? Pops wrote that because of there were 9 children in Little Rock, Arkansas, trying to integrate Central High School. They would meet people. These kids would walk up there every day with their books in their arms, proud. And people would throw stones at them, spit at them, call them names, but they never turned their head. They just kept walking.
That's amazing.
And they were my age. They were, you know, so we would all be on the floor, Pops in his recliner, and we were watching the news. It got so bad, and it lasted so long, the mayor of Arkansas, of Little Rock, the governor of Arkansas, and the president of the United States said, let those children go to school. And, we all wanted to see this on the news. That particular day, the kids were walking. They get right up to the bus, and a policeman put his billy club across the door. And Pop said right then, he said, now, why is he doing that? Why are they treating them so bad?
Yeah.
And he wrote that song from that experience. I tell you, we have had, baby sister, I have seen a lot. I have seen a lot. And it just makes me more prayerful and more willing to sing my songs, you know. Because I don't have to sing love songs. I don't have to be like everybody else. I've seen protest songs.
Yeah.
I've seen to help us.
Move it forward.
Move it forward, right.
Keep moving it forward.
Right.
And we're still going.
We're still going.
Yeah.
And I owe it to Pops. I owe it to my father. You know, we went to South Africa, and these people wanted us to sing, wanted the black people to be in the balcony. Johannesburg. And Pops told them, he said, no. I'm going to allow my children to sing. Like, he said, Dr. King just got that straightened out in the States.
Yeah.
And we're not going to sing like that. He said, now you can send us home. Do what you got to do. We're not singing like that. So they moved our show to the soccer field in Soweto.
Wow.
Soweto. It's all black. You know, this is where the people live in little matchboxes.
Yeah.
And it was the very first time that blacks and whites sit together. No kind of I mean, that soccer field was packed.
That's amazing.
Yeah, and black and white were sitting right next to each other. But they had these, I've never seen a German Shepherd dog so big. Mm. The police was walking around with them, you know, I guess for just in case something went wrong, but it was peaceful. But see, during that time, they wouldn't let us go downtown by ourselves.
That must have been hard to go at all.
It was.
Yeah.
They wouldn't allow it. The kids would tell me, Mavis, we will call you. We will come see you. If they would call, my calls would go to the white girl's room. She would be there, and she would take over, and she wouldn't let the kids talk to me. They wouldn't let them in the hotel to come. It was very educational, very beautiful experience. And
intense.
Intense.
Yeah.
Yes.
You've been on tour, though, since the pandemic, a lot. You've got to tour in these little pockets of touring.
Yeah,
I'm really excited to hear that. I haven't at all yet.
Where?
I just haven't.
You haven't been on tour?
Not since the COVID started.
Oh, okay.
But, you know, I'm excited that you're out there doing it.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
I'm going everywhere.
We're
booked now. On through November.
You're doing a tour with Bonnie Raitt this summer, I heard.
I always do it with
That's
Bonnie.
Amazing.
That'll be my third tour with
You've
Bonnie.
Known her a long time, right?
Oh, yes.
She's great.
Now, you know, Bonnie.
That's going to be a show.
I tell you, it's always a good show.
Yeah.
But I used to be jealous of Bonnie. My father loved her so much.
So you're jealous?
Yeah. And I told her, I said, look, I didn't know if I should get some red hair. Or if I should learn how to play the guitar, or if I should get real tiny, because Pops loved
it. Yeah.
And she loved Pop.
That's
she came
funny.
To see. She came to the house to see Pop
Aww.
When he was sick.
Wow.
And Bonnie took me so bad. Pops went upstairs. He wasn't feeling good. And he went upstairs to lie down. She followed him. She sit on the bed, and she said, now nobody can tell me I haven't been in Pop's stable bed.
That's Bonnie. Yeah, that's Bonnie.
No, it was funny.
Yeah, she's funny.
It was funny. But it was so good. Made Pops feel so much better. He gave her a guitar. He had a guitar. And all of us were there. We sang.
That's beautiful.
It was beautiful.
Isn't it something how music keeps you going?
Yes.
It really keeps you.
Yes.
It keeps you young.
It keeps you young.
It keeps you going. And it's healing.
Yes.
And it brings joy and...
Right.
And
we can't do without music.
I know.
No way.
I get that feeling from you.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah. I pass it on, didn't
You're
I?
Passing it on, yeah. But
Well, I tell you, yours have brought me so much joy. I wish Pops could hear you sing.
Oh, I wish I could watch him play guitar in person.
You know what he would do? He would tell me, now maybe. That's the way you should sing.
Oh no!
That's the way he was.
That's crazy. You know who else? You know who else gave me that feeling? Always was Levon Helm.
Is that right?
Yeah, he gave me that feeling where it was just all music, and it kept him going.
Yes.
And
he just
you know.
Oh man!
And I remember the first time I saw you on TV was watching The Wait on The Last Waltz, and I thought,
yeah.
My goodness, she is beautiful, and she's smoking all of that. I couldn't believe it.
Yeah, you were smoking.
Oh, my God. I was just like, and you looked 6 feet tall in that video.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You look so tall.
Who, me?
Yes.
Oh, no.
You look so tall in the video.
I guess so, yeah.
You do.
We had on those long black gowns.
Yeah, it was beautiful.
And, oh, man.
I mean, I'd heard your singing my whole life, but it was the first time I zeroed in and visually.
Yeah, yeah.
And
that was nice.
I know you had a long friendship with Levon.
Oh, Lord.
Yeah.
Levon. I have an album coming out.
Yeah.
With Levon.
Wow.
And we did it at his barn, and he was right next to me with them drums. But I'll tell you about that. when we were doing The Last Waltz, Levon was smoking, and Pops went back to, we had a break. Levon. Pops go back. They were tight buddies.
They were.
Pops and Levon. And Pop said, "Leave on, man. You smoking two cigarettes?" He had a cigarette. And Levon said, "Oh, Pop, you got to try this one."
I don't think they were the same.
Yeah, they were not the same. Pop said, "Levon, man, I don't think that mess." But that daddy laughed about that forever. He laughed about that. But yeah, Levon, that was the best time. Because we stayed there about a week. We would go back to the barn every day from the hotel and
making the record.
Yeah.
So when did you make it? About 10 years ago.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. Because I was on. I said, "Look, are y'all gonna release this record? Am I gonna be dead and gone or what?" But yeah, it's coming. I think in May.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, I can't wait to hear it.
Yeah, it's been a long time.
I love it. You know, that he's gone, especially, it'll be so special.
Right.
Yeah.
And Amy helped, you know. I tell her about it. I said, "Amy, they need to release the record."
Yeah.
You know, we're getting up in age.
Yeah.
And we might leave here. Me.
No.
So she say, "Maybe some of us are going." They got it going.
Good.
But yeah, that was a proud time.
What songs did you do with Levon? Did you do all old songs? Did you do that that Nina Simone version? What? That's a Billy Taylor song, isn't it? "I Wish I Knew How It Would Feel to Be Free."
That's a Billy Taylor song?
That's what my phone said when I Googled it. Because, I mean, the Nina version is...
I believe it.
But I think it said Billy Taylor wrote it.
Really?
And it's so funny. I saw him play when I was in high school. And I didn't realize that.
Yeah.
But, yeah, that's a great song. Did you record that with Levon?
Yeah.
Yeah.
"I Wish I Knew..." And we recorded "Trouble in Mind."
Oh, I love
that one.
"Trouble
in Mind."
Yeah.
And I love some Nina. Nina.
Did you know her?
Oh, yes.
Well?
Yes.
Yes.
And she was someone I met whose voice was heavier than mine.
Yes. Very much.
Whoa.
Yeah.
And boy, she was bad. I saw her.
So bad.
First saw her in the Village Gate. And she had on all white. She was playing that piano.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden, people... Bam! She stopped and stood up. "Do you people have cotton in your ears?"
Whoa!
She told them off because they were talking while she was singing. "You have cotton in your ears?" And I said, "Whoa! Go on, sister." But we got to know. We got to be very good friends.
That's great.
We were in the Bahamas though. Last time I saw her, we were in the Bahamas. Yeah. And then she moved to New Guinea.
Yeah.
Where Miriam Makeba was.
Okay.
And she passed away over there. But baby sister, we were in New Guinea. Don't you know these little guys? They were in the auditorium where we were singing. They wanted to have a coup against the president or somebody.
Oh, God.
And we got to the show, and we standing at the door. Pops and my sisters and I, and this man is saying, "Staple." That's all we could understand was "Staple."
Man.
You know, and he was telling them, so they still came in with the guns, and they stood on the side of the stage in the wings where we were, and as I was singing, I would look over there a little bit, and they would be just dancing.
Oh, my God. That is crazy.
Yeah, y'all done scared us to death.
You have gone to some wild times places. You've had it.
Yes, yes.
Wow.
Yeah, so we made it through that one.
I do have one more question, if you feel comfortable talking about it.
Yeah.
I was curious about songwriting and the story you told me yesterday.
Yeah.
That broke my heart.
You know, it's been so long ago that I'm surprised I even brought it up.
I mean, I don't know.
Somebody said something about songwriting, and it did. This man, you know, I had written my three songs, and he was at Stax Records. He wanted all of my publishing.
Yeah.
And I'm telling him no. I'm singing 12 songs on the album. You know, you take all that public, but mine, My father's always taught me I should get 100% of my writers and publishing. And he talked to me like, all right, Miss Staples, all right, I understand. Yes, all right, we'll do as you like. And I'm thinking, I've won.
Yeah.
The record come out, and it's on a different label or something. And it's me singing. And then they have songwriter unknown. And I said,
song you wrote?
Yeah, the song that I wrote.
Wow.
And I said, well, you know, it was so long ago. You know, no need in me trying to fix this now. But that broke my heart.
And you didn't write after that.
I didn't write any more songs
but
after that.
But that's the sad part. But you still make all songs your own.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah,
that's just, you know, that stuff happened so much back then. Where
that's
people
crazy.
Would just get...
You know, it's a shame the way people are treated.
Yeah.
You know, it's not just me. You know, I'm sure the record business has been...
It's tricky.
tricky, dicky.
It's tricky, but it was much trickier back then.
Yeah. So. Way back, that was... And I was doing stuff... You know, I was afraid because these were secular songs.
Yeah.
And you do something secular against the gospel stuff. I was lucky. I don't know how it happened. I recorded A House Is Not a Home. I recorded a and the church people didn't say nothing about it.
Yeah, because you got in trouble for that.
I could have gotten
in
trouble.
You could have gotten
in trouble. But they didn't. You know what they messed with? I'll take you there. They wanted to put us out of church.
Oh, wow.
They said the Staple Singers are singing the devil's music.
Well.
The devil's music. I said, you got to listen to our lyrics.
That's crazy.
They heard this beat.
Yeah.
And then people would jump up and dance on I'll Take You There, you know, because... But up until I'll Take You There, we just sang with my father's guitar. We didn't have no rhythm section.
Yeah.
We just sang with Daddy's guitar. And but when this rhythm section came on, I'll Take You There, we're singing the devil's music.
It sounded different.
I told him, I said, look, we're telling you, I know a place. Ain't nobody crying.
I mean,
ain't nobody worried.
That's a gospel song.
It's a gospel
that
song.
That is a gospel song.
I'm talking
song.
About taking you to heaven.
Yeah. I mean.
And lo and behold, after all the interviews we did talking to these people, they invited us back to church. We go back to church. The first song requested in the pulpit, I'll Take You There. You know, you just don't know what to do to please people.
It's true. That's why you got to just speak your truth.
Yes.
Sing your truth.
Right.
And spread some love.
Spread love.
Put out love.
Yes. Put it out there.
And that's what you do.
I'm going to do it. I'm going to keep on doing it.
You are my favorite ball of love.
You are my little sweetheart. I love you so much,
I
girl.
I love you. Do you have one more song in you? Or can I play you a song and you chime in if you want?
Yes.
And we'll end it. We can.
Let's do it.
Pops made the album and the song Friendship.
Oh, yes.
Yeah. And then Jeff and the crew, they kind of fixed it up, right? And recorded all, re-recorded.
Yes.
Like you weren't happy with it and it never got
right.
released.
That's right?
Right.
And Tweety did all that for Pop's album. That's his last work.
Wow.
And I wanted to put it out there, but I wanted to put it out properly and right. And,
So he re-recorded all the stuff that you weren't happy with, right?
Yes.
He took the tracks of Pops and you guys singing.
Mm-hmm. And I was so pleased. I come up in here to listen, and tears just flowed.
Yeah,
you know,
I bet.
My sister Yvonne and I, we came to check it out. Thank you, Jeff Tweedy.
Oh, it's a beautiful recording, and it's a great song.
It is.
That's a pop song?
Yes.
Yeah. It's
a good song.
It's a really good song.
Thank you. wrong, my longtime friend? Something's bothering you. Tell me what the problem is. I see what I can do. There's a times we disagree. We agree more than we don't. We won't always see eye to eye, but we will more than we won't. 'Cause we got friendship, the kind that lasts a lifetime. Through all those hardships, you know you're a friend of mine. We got friendship, the kind that lasts a lifetime. Through all those hardships, you know you're a friend of mine.
You want to sing one?
Oh.
Or not?
Talk to me, old pal of mine, if you feel you can't go on. Don't you sweat, it ain't over yet. This bond we share is strong. I've been where you are right now. You saw me through it all. I leaned on you, now you can lean on me. I bet I won't let you fall. 'Cause we got friendship, kind of lasts a lifetime. Through all the hardship, you know you're a friend of mine.
'Cause we got friendship, the kind that lasts a lifetime. Through all those hardships,
you know you're a friend of mine.
If you're street, I'll take your hand. You're hungry, I'll give you food.
Yeah.
If it's money you need,
I've got some saved.
If you're sick, I'll visit you. I've been where you are right now.
You saw me through it all.
I'll lean on you.
Now you can lean on me. Bet I won't let you fall.
'Cause we got friendship, the kind that lasts a lifetime. Through all those hardships, you know you're a friend of mine. We got friendship, the kind that lasts a lifetime. Through all those hardships,
oh Lord,
you know you're a friend of mine.
Through all the hardships, you know you're a friend of mine. Through all the hardships, you know
you're a friend
of mine. I had to fight to keep from crying, girl.
No, I love that song, and I love you. Thanks for talking with me.
I'm so happy. I'm so happy you invited me. I've never done one of these, what do you call it, a podcast?
Podcast. Well, I'm honored that you joined me. Thank you. Mavis, you are loved by all who know you. Thanks for everything, always.
I hope so, baby sister.
I love you. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm just playing along with you.
Thanks for listening to the show. Oh, that was Mavis Staples.
She's incredible.
Yeah, that was a fun one.
I just want her to call me and tell me everything's going to be okay, because I would believe her.
We should just call her. Hey, can you tell me everything's going to be okay? I'm sure she probably needs to hear it too sometimes.
It's true.
Yeah.
It's true. She is not alone.
In fact, let's wrap this up so we can go call her.
We're
going
to go
tell her
Mavis
how much
now.
We love her. Thanks for listening to the show.
Thank you.
Our show is recorded by Mark Greenberg at The Loft in Chicago, mixed by Jamie Landry, and additional engineering by Greg Tobler. Produced by me and Sarah Oda and moi.
Photography by Shervin Linez. Artwork by Eliza Fry.
See you later.